Welcome to everyone. This is a new class on a new topic, and today's topic of discussion is dimension. If you still don't know what is dimension and why do we need it, then this is the perfect time to learn it. And I hope this class will actually give you basic idea what is the dimension and how we can find a dimension of physical quantities. So let's start. Now, as we know, physical quantity is a quantity that we can actually measure. And physical quantity can be categorized into main two principal sections. One is fundamental quantity, another one is derived quantity. So fundamental quantities are those quantities, those physical quantities, those are independent. That means these quantities don't need anyone to explain. Okay, so that means no other quantity actually is needed to find these fundamental quantities. And as we know, there are seven fundamental quantities. One is length, another one is mass, time, temperature, electric current, luminous intensity, and amount of substance. Okay, these are the main fundamental quantities. And derived quantities are those physical quantities that those are actually measured or found by using the fundamental quantities. Okay, so there are lots of derived quantities. We can't even say the exact number of them. Okay, now why do we need the dimension? So our main aim or motto to find out the dimension is first to verify some equation. So we can actually verify some equation by using the dimension only. In the later half of the class, later part of the class, we will go through some principle called dimensional homogeneity. And by using this principle, we can actually verify our equation. Is it a true equation or it is a false equation? Okay. And next one is, we actually can find the unit of any physical quantity. Okay. Now, what is dimension actually? So, what is the dimension? So, why do we need the dimension? Already I have told you. And what are the physical quantities that we already know? Now, what is the dimension? Dimension is a way of representation of derived quantity in terms of the fundamental quantity. That means this is a way where we actually express a derived quantity in terms of fundamental quantity. Okay, so some example will help you to understand this. So let's start with the example. We will take only three fundamental quantities, that is mass, length and time. Rest of the little bit of complicated for sake of simplicity, and for the beginners that will help you a lot. And one thing you should remember, dimension always expressed within a bracket, okay, within this third bracket. Okay, now let's start by finding the dimension of velocity. Okay, so velocity is a derived quantity because we already know there are seven fundamental quantities and velocity is not in between them. Okay, so what is velocity? Now, by definition, velocity is displacement by time, and displacement is actually a length. So displacement has the dimension of length and time has the dimension of time. That means it is already a fundamental quantity. Displacement is also a fundamental quantity, and that is the length. So the dimension of velocity will be L t to the power minus 1. Okay. Now next one is acceleration, and from the definition, acceleration is velocity divided by time, and velocity is already defined as displacement by time. So acceleration is actually displacement by time square. Displacement is actually length. So our dimension will be L t to the power minus 2. Okay. Now next one is force. Now by definition we can find the force from the second law of motion by the Newton. So that is mass multiplied by the acceleration, that is the product of mass and acceleration. Already this mass is a fundamental quantity, and acceleration, the dimension of acceleration, we already found, that is L t to the power minus 2. Okay, on multiplying them we will get, that is capital M L t to the power minus 2. Okay, so from these three examples, one point that should noted, that should be noted, that to find the dimension, first and foremost thing is that you must know the direct relationship that connects the derived quantity with the fundamental quantities. Okay, so you must know the equations, the basic equation that connects the derived quantity with the fundamental quantities. So that knowledge is really needed to find the dimension of any derived quantity. Okay, and now as I told you, we will go deep in this topic, and this is the principle of dimensional homogeneity that I already mentioned to you. Now I am going to state that this is very simple thing, and just this principle actually states that, it says that the dimension on both side of the equation, that means LHS and the RHS, both side of the equation must have the same dimension. And it's quite obvious, you can't equate 5 liter of water to 5 kg of rice. Okay, that means you only can equate the 5 liter of water to some liter of glycerin or some liter of these things. Okay, that has some logical meaning, but 1 liter of water is exactly equal to 5 kg of rice, that doesn't give you the sense. Okay, so this thing is very much correct, and it is quite obvious that the dimension of the LHS should be equal to the dimension of the RHS of any equation. And this simple principle actually used to find out the dimension of number of parameters used in any equation, and determination of the dimension of any parameter actually gives you a sense of the parameters, like what those parameters are actually, dimension is, what are those parameters. Okay, like those parameters are they volume, or they any kind of modified pressure or something else. Okay, that means actually the determination of dimension of parameters of the any equation, that those are used in any equation, actually gives you the sense of the parameters and how are they related to this equation, and what are the exact meaning of these parameters. Okay, now this is the van der Waals equation for a real gas. Now we are going to find the dimension of A and dimension of B. Okay, so P plus A by V square is multiplied by V minus B equals to RT. This is equation, van der Waals equation for real gas, and it is for 1 mole real gas. And from the principle of dimensional homogeneity, and we can obviously understand this is the sum. Again, the same thing, you can't add 1 kg of rice to 1 liter of water. Okay, so that will not give you any sense. So the since these two terms are adding, so that means the dimension of this term must be equal to the dimension of this term. Okay, so this dimension of P must be equal to dimension of A by V square. Now dimension of P is actually dimension of A by dimension of A, that is force by area. This is the basic equation that defines the pressure. Now from this equation we can find, already I just found the dimension of force and it is mLt to the power minus 2, and the dimension of area is actually L square. By putting these things, just little bit of calculation, you will get mL to the power minus 1 t to the power minus 2. Now just put it here, and the dimension of V square is actually L to the power 6, since volume is L cube and the whole square of L cube is L to the power 6. On multiplying, you will get dimension of A equals to actually dimension of P multiplied by the dimension of V square, and it is mL to the power 5 t to the power minus 2. And again the same things, B is actually being subtracted from V, so that is B equals to, sorry, the dimension of B must be equals to dimension of V. So that is, the dimension of B is actually L cube. Now from this logic, from this idea, you can actually sense what is B, what could be it. Okay, so B is actually reduced volume due to the finite size of the real gas atoms. Okay, the ideal gas atoms are point masses, so they don't have any volume. So this is a volume correction that was actually introduced by the van der Waals. Okay, so that is, I am saying, by finding the dimension you actually sense the parameter what it could be. Okay, now this is another equation, that AS equals to AT plus BT square. It is a very simple equation that connects the displacement with time, where AS is the displacement. Now again the same things, AT is added with BT square, that means the dimension of AT must be equal to the dimension of BT square. Okay, now again this left from using, by using the dimensional homogeneity, we again say that the dimension of the left side of the equation must be dimension of the right side of the equation. That means that dimension of S must be equal to dimension of AT is equal to dimension of BT square. Now just from this equation you can find the dimension of A, that is LT to the power minus 1, dimension of B, that is LT to the power minus 2. So that means the B, this parameter, is actually some kind of acceleration, and A is some kind of velocity. And you know the exact equation, that A is equals to UT plus half of AT square. So A, this UT plus half of AT square, that means this A parameter A is actually the initial velocity, and the parameter B is actually half of the acceleration. Okay, so again by using dimensional homogeneity we also can prove some of the equations. Okay, and that's not very much important for any kind of competitive exam, so we will just stop here. Okay, so thank you everyone.